So, is everyone able to see my screen?
Yes, ma'am.
Great. Okay. So, as sir has already introduced me, I'm Dr. Anupama Singh, and I'm in the Department of Statistics for past 6 years right now. So, in the past few lectures, you would have already got to know the basic of statistics, that what statistics is about, how it is defined, and how it is applicable in all of your research fields, right? So basically, today we are going to study testing of hypothesis, but it is part of inference, right? So statistical inference is divided into two parts. One is point estimation and interval estimation, and another one is testing of hypothesis. So in point estimation or interval estimation, what we do is, we get the sample data and we try to estimate the values of the population parameters using the sample statistic. Okay, another part is testing of hypothesis, which is basically required when you go for research, any kind of research, whether it is scientific or social. So in that, you make certain kind of statements, hypothetical statements about your study, and then you need to check whether your statements that you have made are correct or not, or valid or not, right? So that comes into the part of testing of hypothesis. So I hope everyone is a little bit familiar with the concept of statistics, right? So in statistics, we collect data and we analyze data, and then we conclude our results. So basically, there are two types of statistics. One is descriptive and another one is research based. So in descriptive, we basically go for what you say, the graphs and the presentation of the data. And the theoretical statistics deals with the development of statistical theories and all. But here we are not going to talk about the theories of the statistical background, okay? Because here we are concentrating on the application of SPSS software on using different kind of statistics, right? So is everyone familiar with the basic concepts of SPSS, right? What kind of variables are there are, and how the variable is input, and how the data is imported into SPSS. So you can speak up whenever we are talking so that it would feel like I'm interacting with you, right? So, well, so the data have already been shared with you, the practice data set. So this was the data set, first data set, sample t-test would be written there, right? So this is the variable view. We all know that SPSS has two windows. One is the data window and another one is the output window, right? So these are the specifications of each and every variable. So in this practice data set, I have taken a very simple data set. It's a dummy data set, and in which a group of people, a group of basically 24 people each, they were shown a picture of a spider, and they were shown the actual spider, the real spider, and then the level of anxiety were checked among both the groups, right? So that's that kind of study. So in this study particularly, they wanted to know that whether a picture or a real spider changes the levels of anxiety in different group of people, right? So one is control group, another one is the experimental group. So, well, so we'll get back to that later. So let's talk about, first of all, a little bit of testing of hypothesis. So what do we understand about testing of hypothesis? We know there are two terms, important terms. One is testing and another one is hypothesis, right? So in testing of hypothesis, what we are doing is we make some kind of hypothetical statement about a study, right? And then we try to test it using statistical tools, methodologies, or statistical tests, and we come out to a conclusion that the statement made by us is whether it is true or not, or at what extent it is true, right? How significant are the results? So the whole process is called as testing of hypothesis. For example, let's take an example. So let's see, if we have a class of 30 students and we want to study the impact of the counseling that we are providing to the students, right? So we want to know whether the counseling is making any kind of difference among the students. So for that, we'll have to conduct an experiment, right? We cannot just go to the conclusion that, of course, the counseling will make a difference. So what we do is we can divide the whole class of students. Let's say there are 30 students. So we can divide the class of students into two subgroups, let's say 15 and 15. And one will be our experimental group and another will be the control group. Experimental group will be the one who are getting the counseling, and the control group will be the one who are not getting the counseling. But other situations will be the same. The level of tests and the level of classes regular and the level of material, study material they're getting, rest all will be the same, but one is getting counseling and another one is not. So here the question arises that how do we test that, how do we check whether the counseling has made any difference among the group of people or not? So there we can make a statement, we can make a hypothesis, and then we can use testing of hypothesis, the methods behind that, and we can derive in, and we can come to an inference that the counseling did actually make any difference, right? So there's this kind of example. So that is basically related to education and psychology. Another one example that I came through in zoology. So one colleague of mine, they were conducting an experiment on some kind of insect, and they wanted to study that if we have some insect and we try to control the temperature and breed them, or some kind of modification we want to bring. So they were studying the effect of temperature on the breeding of that particular insect, right? So again, the situation is the same. What we do is we try to make two groups and we try to identify whether the temperature is making the difference or not. So see, what I am trying to say here is that we have made some kind of hypothetical statement that we want to test, right? That the counseling or the temperature is making any kind of difference in the group of students or insects respectively. So what we'll do is we'll have to make a statement, hypothesis, and then we'll have to check it. So these two part, the hypothesis, the one statement that you make is called as null hypothesis. Anyone familiar with the null hypothesis concept?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, can you please tell me?
So, ma'am, basically null hypothesis expresses that there is a no difference between variable.
Correct. So, well, the null hypothesis is called as the hypothesis of no difference, right? Or we can say that we make a statement for possible rejection, right? So in the beginning of the study, we cannot be biased related to any kind of conclusion. Okay, so when we are taking the example of the study of counseling, the effect of counseling over the group. So in that case, our null hypothesis will be something like, there is no difference of counseling in any of the groups, right? So that will be our null hypothesis. For that, we'll have to make an alternate hypothesis against which the null hypothesis is to be tested. So any alternate hypothesis, any hypothesis which is contradicting the statement of null hypothesis is called as alternate hypothesis. Okay, so for that example, for example of 30 students, what we can do is we can check, we can take a test and we can check that whether the average marks of the students of one group are particularly higher than the average marks of the students of the another group, right? So the average we are talking about. So we are checking that mean, whether the mean of one group is equals to the mean of another group of no group or not. So if we make a null hypothesis in that, the null hypothesis will be the hypothesis of no difference. Okay, so no difference will be that the mean of one group is equal to the mean of another group. And the alternate hypothesis will be either the mean of group one is less than mean of group two, the mean of group one is greater than mean of group two, or the mean of group one is not equals to the mean of group two. See, I have made three alternate hypotheses here. So you can go for any one or all three depending on your study. Okay, so depending on your study, it depends what kind of alternative hypothesis you make. Okay, so the first two hypotheses that I said, the alternate hypothesis of less than and greater than, are considered in the single-tailed testing of hypothesis. And when you are saying that mean 1 is not equals to mean 2, then we are saying that the mean can go in either of the direction, whether left side or right side. So that is called as the two-tailed significance test. Okay. So let's see. So how it comes into the existence. So when we are talking about testing of hypothesis, and we already stated that null hypothesis and alternate hypothesis. So there are the possibilities of two kinds of error that you can commit, right? So the decision that you take is basically rejecting and accepting, okay? So in statistical language, we don't say strictly that we reject, we accept the alternate hypothesis. We usually say we fail to reject null hypothesis because we didn't get enough evidence to accept the null hypothesis. Okay, so it's easier to say in that way. So when we are testing the hypothesis, so as you can see the screen here, so we have rejection and failing to reject or acceptance of null hypothesis, and two conditions will arise that whether your null hypothesis is true or your null hypothesis is actually false. So in that situation, when you are rejecting the null hypothesis and the null hypothesis is actually false, then it will be a correct decision to make, right? And another situation can arise is when the null hypothesis is true and you're accepting the null hypothesis or you're not rejecting the null hypothesis. So that these two conditions will be the correct conditions, apt conditions, right? The problem arises when you commit some kind of error. So error, what kind of error can happen? So there's a possibility that you reject your null hypothesis even when your null hypothesis is true. For example, let's say a car manufacturer, it's a very common example. So a car manufacturer who's manufacturing cars and he's going to launch his car in the market, and he claims that the average mileage that his or her car giving is 15 mph, 15 kilometers per liter. Okay, so now what happens is you're going to test that. So your null hypothesis will be according to the manufacturer that mu is equals to 15, right? So what happens is what you're doing is you're drawing a sample. You cannot go and you cannot run each and every car and then you study okay, average outcome jo tha accordingly hua ya nahi hua, right? What you'll do is you'll take out a sample, you'll take out a bunch of cars, right? For example, if he's going to manufacture 1,000 cars and you're going to launch it, then first, you'll have to take a sample of, let's say, 10 cars. Okay, so the 10 cars would be run and the average mileage in all those 10 cars would be analyzed, right? And then you'll see that whether the cars are giving 15 average or not, right? 15 ka mileage mil raha hai ya nahi mil raha hai. So there's a possibility that the car is actually giving the mileage of 15. But what happened was the sample that you got was a sample in which those particular cars were giving lesser mileage, right? So based on that particular sample, you rejected the null hypothesis that the mileage was 15, but it was actually true, right? So now what happened was that in this particular condition, we commit a probability, we commit a error that is called as type 1 error, okay? And so this is one situation. Another situation that can arise is the same guy is saying that the average, the mileage will be 15, okay? But actual mileage is not 15. The mileage is less, and the sample you got was a good sample and it gave the mileage of above 15, right? So in that case, what you'll do? You'll do is what you are going to accept the null hypothesis or fail to reject, right? So you're going to accept the null hypothesis where in actual terms, the null hypothesis was false. So that is another kind of error, which is called as type 2 error. Based on these two type of errors, we define the level of significance and the power of the test. Okay, so you would be,
Ma'am, please repeat the type 1 and type 2 error. Please explain.
Sure. So was the example apt for you? Okay, I'll change the example, let's say. So let's assume that a pharmacological company, they are going to launch some kind of medicine. They want to launch some kind of medicine. And they are saying that the medicine is provides quick recovery and the lesser amount of side effects, right? Okay, so let's see. So the hypothesis here would be that the medicine is making a difference, is making no difference. ठीक? या हम ये कह सकते हैं कि जो producer, जो pharmacology producer, जो the one who's producing the medicine, they are saying that it will recover the patient in 5 days. Okay? So what we'll do is we'll make a null hypothesis here, right? So the null hypothesis will be average recovery day is equals to 5. ठीक है? Number of days in which a person is recovering is equals to 5. Now what you will do is you will collect some sample data. What happened? What will happen? You will give that particular medicine to a group of people, a smaller group of people, and then you will test whether the number of days of recovery is equals to 5 or not. Clear? So what you're doing here is you're stating the null hypothesis that the number of days of recovery are 5, and your alternate hypothesis will be the number of recovery days is not equals to 5. Okay? So now here what can happen is it is possible that the number of days of recovery are actually less than 5, less than equals to 5. But somehow the sample gets the value in which the number of recovery of days are greater than 5. Okay? So the medicine was correct, but the sample somehow gave the values of less than 5. So now we will reject the null hypothesis, where actually the null hypothesis was true, right? So there is type 1 error. There is an error and we call it a type 1 error, okay? Another situation can arise in which the medicine was actually faulty and it didn't give the recovery days as the producer said. So, but the sample somehow came to be like in which the number of recovery days were less than 5. So you are going to accept the null hypothesis, whereas the null hypothesis was actually false. Are you getting it now?
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. So these errors that can happen while you are testing the hypothesis. So you would have heard the terms like level of significance, right? Alpha, beta, mostly alpha hi suna hoga aap logon ne. So the probability of type 1 error basically is called as alpha, okay? Or you can say the level of significance. And the probability of occurrence of type 2 error is called as beta. Okay, so these kind of alpha and beta, these are the two errors that can occur while testing of a hypothesis. Now, what we try to do is we try to minimize the error. In statistics, we always try that the error is minimized in one way or another. But the thing is, if you try to reduce the type 1 error, the type 2 error automatically increases. The sum is actually equals to 1. Okay, so these are the probabilities whose sum is equals to 1. So if you reduce one, the next one, other one will increase. Or if you reduce the other one, the first one will increase. So our effort is to minimize the error in a way that our testing could be better, could provide better results. Okay, so what we do is that according to producer's view, usually when we say type 1 error, it is producer's risk. In commercial terms. So what we think is that the commitment of type 1 error is serious, is as compared to commitment of type 2 error. So what we do is that we fix alpha, as we see that the alpha is more serious kind of error that can happen during testing of hypothesis. So what we do is we fix the type 1 error or alpha or the level of significance, as you can say, and we try to minimize the other one, the type 2 error. Okay, so that is the whole idea of testing of hypothesis and the level of significance. Now you are right now, yes, you would be thinking what level of significance actually is. So when you hear that the level of significance is 5% or 1% or 10%. Basically, that means what are the chances of you committing error? What are the allowable chances of you committing an error? Okay, so everyone has seen the normal distribution, right? It sits like this. So don't go through the acceptance or rejection region just for now. Just see that this is a normal distribution. By normal distribution, we are saying that usually the natural phenomena or the characteristics under study, when we are talking about your characteristics on a larger scale or very larger scale, they all follow a normal distribution. A normal distribution which goes like this, bell-shaped. Okay, so when we are saying that the level of significance is, say, 5% or 1%. So we are saying that the probability of rejecting something is 5%. That means that you can reject your null hypothesis. That error, that percent of error will be 5%. Okay, allowable. So that is called as level of significance. That means there is 95% of the chances that your null hypothesis will lie in the acceptance region. It has a 95% area, and only 5% of area where can you can commit the error. So the error has to be signified by the seriousness of your research study. So here we have taken the example of 5% level of significance, okay, which gives you the 95% confidence interval, or we can say this is the acceptance region. So this region,
I didn't understand this significance thing.
बिल्कुल मैं कर देती हूँ, ठीक है. सो बेसिकली लेवल ऑफ सिग्निफिकेंस से हम ये कहना चाह रहे हैं कि कितना परसेंट एरर आप उसमें कर सकते हैं, कितना परसेंट एरर आपको अलाउड है, right? That is level of significance. Okay, so when we are saying ke hum log ek medicine ko launch kar rahe hain, when we are launching a medicine in the market, so getting a wrong medicine in the market would be hazardous, right? So in that case, our probability of committing an error should be lesser and lesser as possible, right? So when we are saying that the alpha, your level of significance, is 1%, That means you have only 1% chances to commit an error. You cannot commit an error for more than 1% of your whole data. Right? For example, if you are giving 1,000 medicines, there will be only 1% of the medicine that can be faulty, not more than that. That is your level of significance. That is, you cannot allow any error more than 1% of the complete data. Okay, another example, let's say that let's say there's a manufacturer of pen. Okay, so what you do is he's manufacturing, say, some lakhs of pen. Okay, now the producer will say that I can make average, on an average, I'll be this much of pen will be fine. Okay, now what consumer says is, let's say consumer only. So the consumer says that you have only 10, you have 10% level of significance that your product is going to qualify that quality criteria. Okay, so that means the producer has the liberty that 10% of all the pens that is manufacturing or supplying in the market can be faulty. Are you getting my point? A little bit? I'll explain again.
Madam, sorry to intervene, please.
Yeah.
Madam, the significance you are telling about, is it basis on the cost or the quality of data or quality of research you are telling? As you give example, by looking at the patient, the significance is higher. If it is a product in terms of any material object, the significance is going to be lower. So that context, it is significant, or it is the number that is significant?
See, both the situations that you said, they are different kind of situation. One is the testing on the patient. So we are losing, if the treatment or the medicine goes wrong, the patient would die, right? So that will be a serious error, right? So in that situation, our level of significance would be very low, like 1%. 1% means that you have only the chances of committing error 1% in the whole data, right? And at the other part, we are considering a kind of manufacturing process. In that, if the manufacturing process goes wrong, the some amount of your product will come out to be faulty. So in that case, we can keep our level of significance a little bit higher as 5% or 100%. That too depends on the manufacturing of the product. What kind of product are you manufacturing? For example, when I said the manufacturer of medicine, so if a faulty medicine comes into the market, it will be very bad for the population, right? It will be hazardous for the population. So in that matter, we'll have to keep the level of confidence very, significance level very smaller, right? So that there are lesser and lesser chances of getting a faulty medicine, because it is being conveyed to the population, human population. So it will, the results can be catastrophic, right? And if we are talking about the material, then we can be a little bit liberal. The whole thing that your level of significance is saying is that how confidently a producer can say that his product is good, or how confidently you can say that you're in your research, the conclusions that you have drawn are correct. Okay, so what let's say we are conducting a small study. Let's not go for the medicines or anything like that. So let's just say that we were considering 30 students, right? And we were saying that the impact of counseling was important or not, right? So what we did was we divided the group of students in the two subgroups. One was experimental and one was control group. So now what we do is we fix a level of significance. We fix a level of significance, alpha. Alpha is the probability of committing type 1 error. Don't forget that. So alpha is the probability of committing type 1 error. If you are fixing it to 5%, right? So the probability of committing the type 1 error will be 5%. And the remaining 95% will be where the type 1 error will not occur, where the null hypothesis will be accepted, right? The type 1 error is the probability of rejecting null hypothesis when it is true. So it will be the opposite situation. It will be the acceptance of null hypothesis when it is true. You're getting my point right now. So you're fixing your alpha on 5%. That shows that the chances of committing type 1 error or the chances of rejecting null hypothesis when it is true is 5%. So when we are talking about the whole area, so the whole area probability is 1. So this comes out to be 0.05, obviously. ठीक है, दिस इज सिंगल टेल्ड. यहाँ देखिए, द एच नॉट इज म्यू इज इक्वल्स टू म्यू नॉट एंड ऑल्टरनेट हाइपोथेसिस इज म्यू इज लेस देन म्यू नॉट. ओके, सो व्हेन यू आर सेइंग दैट योर अल्फा इज 5%, सो द रिजेक्शन रीजन वेयर द नल हाइपोथेसिस विल बी रिजेक्टेड विल लाइ समवेयर अराउंड हियर एंड इट विल बी 5%. सो दिस पर्टिकुलर एरिया दैट इज शोन इन द रेड बार्स is actually 5% of the total area. Okay, and the rest of the area will be 95%, and where the null hypothesis will be true, or you can say that it
is
will
it
be
one tailed test. This is one tailed test or two tailed?
This is one tailed, and this is basically left tailed.
Okay.
Okay. So I was trying to explain alpha. So this is left tailed test. In left tailed, what you do is earlier I said that we can consider three kind of hypothesis, alternate hypothesis, right? So one was mu less than mu naught, another one was mu greater than mu naught, and the last one was mu naught equals to mu naught. Okay, so the first alternate hypothesis that you considered was where the value of mean is less than the value of mean that we assumed in null hypothesis. So that is called as left tailed test. Left-tailed test means the level of confidence or the level of significance lies in the left tail of the normal distribution. Okay, so this is left-tailed test in which the level of significance is considered as 5%, or you can say the alpha is 0.05. So the acceptance regions for H naught will be 95%, or इसी को आप कह सकते हैं that we can say with 95% confidence level that our decision of rejecting or accepting hypothesis will be true. This much of confidence you have on your study, that we are conducting a study and we are drawing a conclusion. So if you are accepting or rejecting the null hypothesis, the confidence interval will be 95%. Okay. Now I assume a little bit of it will be clear to people.
So ma'am,
yeah,
if the result of the hypothesis, it comes below 5%, it means do I reject the hypothesis?
Yes, definitely.
Only so, if it comes at 5% or crosses 5% in the one tailed test, then only the null hypothesis is accepted.
Yes, definitely. So the concept of p-value is based on this only. So we are saying, we can see here that the alpha is 0.05, right? So the p-value gives the values of your calculated statistic. We'll get to it in a few minutes. So let's just concentrate on left-tailed and right-tailed test here. You got it right, completely right. So if our value lies in the 5% portion of this distribution, then we will have to reject the null hypothesis. And if the value is above the 5%, then we accept the null hypothesis. Okay, so this is the left tail test in which mu is less than mu naught. We are using mu here because it's a general notation. The parameter could be something else also. The mu represents mean usually. Otherwise, you can consider variance, or you can consider mean, or whatever measure of central tendency or variation you are using. Okay. Now, this is the right-tailed test. Okay, so in this part we can see that the rejection region, the region where H naught is rejected, is lying on the right tail of the normal distribution. Okay, so the null hypothesis will be mu equals to mu naught. The alternate will be mu greater than mu naught. The mu naught will be the value of the parameter stated in null hypothesis, the hypothetical value that you are saying. Okay, now this is your two-tailed test. So now what happens in two-tailed test is that if we fix the level of significance at say 5%, so the total of the area, the total of the rejection area for null hypothesis, it can be either on the left side or right side. So what we do is we consider that 2.5% will lie on the left side and 2.5% will lie on the right side. Okay, so it is equally divided. And the region of acceptance for null hypothesis, that will be the middle region, and that will be 95%. So here we have just taken the 5% level of significance. You get it? If we would have taken the significance level of 1%, so in that case, what would have happened? In single tailed, this particular region on the right, this would be 1%, or you can say the alpha will be 0.01, the value of alpha. Okay. Or agar aap next case dekhe, jahan pe we are considering two-tailed test. So in that part, what will happen? So you are dividing 1% in two equal parts. So what will be it be? How will it be divided? So it will be 0.5% on one part and 0.5% on the another part. Get it? So the value will be alpha ka value kya ho jayega? 0.005. Okay, so that will be your alpha. So what happens is in SPSS, we have both kind of tests available. The value that they give, the p-value that they give, is both single-tailed and two-tailed, but it depends. For some kind of tests, they give two-tailed values, and for some kind of tests, they give one single-tailed values also. And there are some kind of tests where you can modify the level of significance according to you, but mostly it is 5% level of significance. Okay, so that is the default setting of SPSS. Now the p-value, the important part, p-value, because SPSS calculates the p-value. Okay, so basically in easier terms, the p-value is the probability of getting the right decision of rejecting or accepting null hypothesis based on your study. So it is the estimated probability of rejecting the null hypothesis of your study when the hypothesis is actually true, right? So it is the estimated probability of alpha based on your sample. So ye jo aap fix kar rahe hain yahan pe, this, so this is the fixed alpha for you that you are fixing on your study. Now the software calculates the p value based on the sample values that you have, okay, and it gives you the values of the probability of rejecting H naught when H naught is true, the values of alpha. Okay, so if the value is less than 0.05, then it says to reject the null hypothesis because it will lie in this region or this region, or otherwise if it is greater than 0.05, you have to accept the null hypothesis. So you just have to remember that if the p value is less than 0.05, the null hypothesis is accepted, and if the value of p is greater than 0.05, the null hypothesis is accepted in SPSS and all over other softwares also. And also the default null hypothesis that any software considers is actually the hypothesis of no difference. if you are stating that your hypothetical value has to be some kind of number, then you have to specify in the software that whether your mean is equals to 25 or 35 or 40, whatever it is. Okay, otherwise it will just consider two samples and it will make it will try to analyze itself. Okay, so it takes the default hypothesis as null hypothesis. Jaisa definition keh raha hai null hypothesis ka, okay, that it should be a hypothesis of no difference or unbiased, right? Unbiased hypothesis hona chahiye wo. So it will consider that and gives you the results based on that. Okay, so p value you are clear. So let's just take one simple example. We have to consider.
Yeah, ma'am, just one question. In a two-tailed test, so yeah, the p value will be distributed as 0.025, right, on either side?
On either side, yes.
So hypothesis will be rejected if it is less than
software, see, when we check the values manually in the table, right? So what happens is the actual values in the table that they give are actually 0.0, from 0 to 0.5. So when we consider two-tailed test, we actually add it,
okay,
or we divide it, right? So the whole value. So the software does the same thing. It gives you two-tailed value, but it compares it to the value 0.05 only. So you don't have to go for 0.025. Okay.
It gives you the cumulative value.
Yeah. So it's giving you the equivalent value of either, if it is a single tailed, then also you go for 0.05. And even if it is two tailed, you compare it with 0.05 only, because it's dividing the whole 5% into two parts. And the values that you calculate manually, it's basically the normal distribution like this. So the probability tables, they give you the value from 0 to 0.5. For the next 50% of the area, you have to add up the values. Okay, so right, you can simply consider the two-tailed values.
Right, thank you.
Okay, so there are two kinds of testing of hypothesis, and I believe that you are going to learn about them in the later lectures. But I was just going to take a simple, very simple question. So let's see. So this was the data. I hope everyone has the data, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Respond accordingly.
So, okay. So we have this data. I told you that we have a data of 24 people around, where you have given shown the group of people a picture of spider and the real spider, and you noted their anxiety levels, right? So we are just going to check whether this particular data is normal or not. Okay, so see, before that, the normality test is actually one sample Kolmogorov-Smirnov test, in which we test that whether our data is coming from a normal distribution or not. Okay, so before you apply any kind of parametric or non-parametric test, you need to understand that the first assumption of parametric test is that the parent population, or the population from where your sample is drawn, is coming from a normal distribution. Okay, if it is following the assumption of normality, then only you can apply the parametric tests. Okay, the larger, see, most of the distribution, they tend to normal distribution when the sample size is made extremely big. Okay, so one assumption is for normality, that the parent population is normal, or otherwise the parent population should be known what kind of distribution it is. And it is seen that whether that particular distribution can be approximated to normal distribution or not. So, well, in simpler words, mostly whether it is binomial distribution or exponential distribution or uniform distribution or Pareto's or any kind of distribution that you're considering, most of the distributions we have, they follow normal distribution when the sample size is made really large. Okay, but it is assumed. But in reality, when we go for studies, there are some cases when the when your sample data does not follow normal distribution. So in that situation, the non-parametric testing of hypothesis comes into existence, that if the parent population, the distribution of parent population is unknown, or if it is not following any normal distribution, then you can opt for non-parametric distributions. So let's see, here is the data, and we want to understand whether this particular data is coming from a normal distribution or not. Okay, so I'm directly taking the practical example. You can right away open your SPSS and go for it. So what you're going to do is you want to test whether your level of anxiety, see, any kind of parametric test will be applied on anxiety and this group only, right? So we want to check whether this anxiety level in both the groups, they follow normal distribution or not. Okay, so there are two ways by which you can check the normality. The easier and popular way is going for the graph. We can study the histogram, or we can study the box plot. Okay. And another way is to check using test, some kind of test. Okay, so both ways we can do. So let's first go for test, and then we'll go for box plots also. So you can go to analyze, go into your tabs, go to analyze, and then go to non-parametric tests. You don't have to opt for the first three options. Go to legacy dialogues, okay? And then there is one sample, k-test. Yes. Click on that. So this is saying that if you want to check whether your sample belongs to a normal population or not. Okay, so we are going to input that particular variable, anxiety. And now in the lower box, SPSS provides you options, right? So the test distribution can be normal, uniform, Poisson, or exponential, right? So usually when you go for any kind of analysis in SPSS or any kind of analysis in your study, so usually we check whether the population is normal or not, if I'm right. There are very fewer cases when we assume that the parent population can be exponential. Easier is to assume whether it is normal or not. And the thing is that theoretically also and practically too, if a sample belongs to Poisson distribution, then you can easily prove that when the sample size goes very large, then the Poisson distribution also tends to the normal distribution. Same is the case with uniform distribution and your exponential distribution. But you can check any kind of distribution here, that the parent distribution is whether it is Poisson, uniform, or exponential. So right now we are only going to test whether the sample is coming from the normal distribution or not, right? So you have to just click on the normal distribution, and it is there by default. For exact test, you don't have to select anything because it goes for simulations, and don't want any kind of simulations. We just want the current sample to be tested. In the options, you get an option for whether you want any kind of descriptives about your sample data or not. So in the descriptions, it will show whether what is the mean of the sample data, what is the variance, what is the range, okay, minimum, maximum. And the quartiles, we all know quartiles divides the whole data into four equal parts. So it will tell you where the first quartile is lying and where the second quartile and third quartile and so on. So you can either choose that or not, it's up to you. Continue and press okay. Okay. So the first tab here, it shows the syntax that the SPSS ran, okay? The first tab, just a second. My laptop is a little bit slow, I think. Okay. So the next table shows the descriptive statistics of your characteristic under study. Okay. So here it is saying that we have the variable is named as anxiety. The total number of observations are 24. Mean is 43. Standard deviation is 10.5. Minimum value is this much and maximum value is this much. And since we didn't click on the quartiles, I guess, so it will it is showing the percentiles where the 25th percentile is 50. Property of percentile that the 50th percentile shows the median of the distribution. So it will show the positional value of the measure of central tendency. So so it is clear, it is just the simple descriptive statistic here. The next is your one sample KS test. So it is showing the mean and standard deviation, that is simple as above. Most extreme, it is based on the statistic of the KS test statistic. The value of the statistic will be 0.720. And see, the asymptotic significance it is taking is two-tailed and it is coming out to be 0.678. So the reason why I went for this example was just to for you to be clear about the level of significance that the software considers. So we saw that there was no option for us to change the level of significance in this particular test given by SPSS. So that it, by default, it is taking 5%, okay? And by default, it is giving you two-tailed significance. यहाँ पे आपके पास में सिंगल टेल का कोई ऑप्शन नहीं है ओके सो इट विल टेल यू दैट द वैल्यू इज कमिंग आउट टू बी 0.678 एंड नाउ व्हाट हैपेंस इज इफ द वैल्यू इज ग्रेटर देन 0.05 यू एक्सेप्ट द हाइपोथेसिस और रिजेक्ट द हाइपोथेसिस नल हाइपोथेसिस सॉरी
मैम
हाँ जी
I'm
sorry, I'm not able to hear you clearly.
Ma'am, am I audible now?
Yeah, yeah. Yes, you are.
Ma'am, when I'm clicking on analyze and after that I'm going to non-parametric test. And mm-hmm. from there I'm clicking on one sample. Ma'am, but like kind of dialog box you are getting.
Yeah, yeah.
And the I am getting is a bit different. Over here I'm getting objective field settings like that.
See, I told you to leave the first three options and go to legacy dialogues. Right? Go to analyze, go to non-parametric, go to legacy dialogues, and then go to one sample KS test.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
That is the correct path.
Thank you.
So everyone is getting the same results, I'm sure.
Take yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So,
ma'am, can you repeat, please? Can you repeat, please?
The path?
Yes, the okay. way you have described. Can you please?
Sure.
Repeat.
Sure. Go to analyze, then find non-parametric tests, then leave the first three options, one sample, independent sample, related sample. Don't go into that. Go to legacy dialogues, and then select one sample KS test.
Yes, ma'am. After that.
Okay. So you are selecting that. Now, we have your we have our variables in the left box, right? So you will have to choose your variable, the variable that you want to test for KS test, right? So spider in picture, I don't want to test. I want to test whether our anxiety is normally distributed or not. It's a scale variable, right? We know the difference between scale variable, nominal and ordinal, right? So we are taking the levels of anxiety and we are putting that into our test variable list. You can take two variables. It will give you the analysis of two variables. But right now, let's just take one for the simplicity. Okay. Then there is this exact box. It's for simulation. We don't want to do go for simulation. It takes time, and we don't have that much of complicated study in which we want to simulate the data. So there is no need for that. Then we go for options. Okay. In the options, it will ask you that whether you want any kind of descriptive statistics along with it or not. The next box is about the missing values, but we don't have any missing values in our data. So we don't have to bother about that either. Okay. So we choose descriptive since we wanted descriptive and quartiles if you want it. Okay. So I have already applied it. Then put go for continue and then press OK. So in the box that is given on the left bottom, it is the test distribution. So the test distribution, they ask you that what can be your the parent population, right? What distribution that you want your sample values to be tested to. Okay. So if I want to test that my sample is coming from a normal distribution, I will opt for normal distribution. If I want to test that whether my sample values are coming from a uniform distribution, then I will go for uniform distribution. Similarly, if I want to test it with Poisson or exponential, then I'll choose Poisson or exponential. Now the KS test is very simple. It shows the normality. It is the normality test. So we opt for normal distribution only. And the one more idea behind it is that we assume that whatever our sample values are, any kind of distribution, whether it is Poisson or exponential, they all tend to normal distribution when the sample size becomes large. Okay, so we don't have to go for that. In any particular detailed research study, if you think that your distribution can be Poisson, then you can go for Poisson or exponential or uniform as per your requirement. But right now we are just checking the normality of your data. Okay. So we'll check the normality and then we'll click OK.
Hello, ma'am. My exact option is not active.
Exact option is not acting.
Yes, ma'am. Only option button is active.
Okay. Well, you have chosen your test variable, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Which variable have you taken?
One sample KS test.
That is okay. When you are opting for one sample KS test, have you selected the anxiety one? Great. So there might be some other reason behind that because it should not happen. You can try once canceling the whole test and going opting for it again. Otherwise, the box with exact name on it, exact test is not important for you. It will never be. So you can ignore it. Otherwise, if you are curious, then you can just close it and reopen it again.
Thank you.
So we are clear about the path, right? So we can run.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. So click on OK. I'll click cancel because my analysis was already done here. So you'll get these two tables. Agar aapne quartile bhi select kiya hua hota option mein, to quartiles bhi it would have shown. So currently it is showing whether your levels of anxiety is distributed normally or not. Okay. So the asymptotic significant value for a two-tail test is coming out to be 0.678. So what will be your decision?
To accept.
Not significant.
Because आपका 0.6 आपने बोला ना.
So they are not.
We cannot reject the null hypothesis.
Correct. So we don't have enough evidence to reject our null hypothesis. So what we do is we accept our null hypothesis and we say that the distribution is normal. Okay, the null hypothesis is the distribution is not normal. And so we accept our, I just said the reverse word. Okay, So in case we are here, we are accepting, we are saying that the distribution is normal. Clear?
Ma'am, can I just ask a question?
Yeah, sure.
My data, when I applied this, I did not probably check the confidence interval. So now when the analysis has come, the confidence interval is 99%, whereas we were setting it at 95.
Yeah.
And by default. But mere system mein, I did not check the confidence interval, thinking ki by default it is 95.
Yeah, but it should be like that. I don't know how is that possible. Because there is no option to check.
I don't know.
There's actually no option to check. How it is showing you 99%
confidence interval, lower bound 0.188, upper bound 0.209.
Okay. Are you sure you have opted for the correct options?
Yes, ma'am. Main phir se isko try karu?
Chalo, bilkul, please. Yes, you should, because...
Okay, main phir se karti hoon.
Sure. Everyone else has got the results, right? I'm sorry. Please speak a little bit louder.
Ma'am, the case that it is instead of that, instead of 0.720, I am getting, it is written test statistic 0.147.
And I'm using the same data.
Yes, ma'am.
You're using the same data set, right?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, the rest of things has arrived, but only the last two part it is not coming. In the asymptotic significance, it is coming instead of 0.678.
Yes, ma'am. Same here.
Even same here, ma'am.
This should not happen.
Even same here, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. I'm also getting the same results.
And so, can you tell me what level of significance it is taking? Is there any option? Do you have any option? Or it is the same thing as 99%? Or 95% issue that the participant was having?
Ma'am, 99% confidence level, interval, lower bound 0.188 and upper bound 0.209.
Yes, ma'am. Same I'm getting.
So everyone with the different test statistic value and significant value are getting these options?
Yes, ma'am.
Let me see, are the participants allowed to share the screen?
Yes, ma'am. No problem.
Okay, so the participant showing the 99% confidence interval, can please share the screen if possible, because I would like to see why is it happening, because it's not happening at my side. And I'll stop presenting for a while and you can please share the screen. Maybe...
Ritupurna, please share your screen.
Yeah, please. What version of SPSS are you using?
Ma'am, I am using 28.1.
Okay, yeah. I get it. Okay. Maybe they have updated this. I am using the version 21. So, it's okay. It's all right. Please share your screen. At least I'll be able to explain a little bit.
In this way, we are not able to read.
Okay. I am, sir, there is some connectivity issue. So, you can ask others to share the screen, please.
Yes. Anyone else?
Yes, please.
Saidal ji, aap share kijiye.
Sir, actually, maine do laptops khol ke rakhe kaam karne ke liye.
Anyone else?
Can anyone share the screen? if possible.
Yes, Vijay.
Well, it's showing all the same values, but the values, the calculated values
are
very different.
Am I audible, ma'am?
Yes, you are.
Just the significance level is like coming at 0.195, despite following the same step we have followed.
Yes, I don't know why it is happening. It should not happen. Because they both are calculating the values based on the sample. And the
can
sample
I do it once,
same.
Like non-parametric test, then
yes,
legacy
yes.
dialog. Then this is the thing, then
yeah.
No, we can change our like confidence level from by clicking on Monte Carlo thing.
But we are not doing
so. Let's continue. Then this, then option. This is descriptive quartile.
Yeah.
Continue. Then okay. See, ma'am. Again, we are getting the same result. 0.195.
There may be change in the data.
I have downloaded the same data you have provided by
we
mail.
Have the same data. I don't know why this is happening.
Even I have got this one only. 0.1.
Yeah.
This
everyone
is the same data.
Everyone has the same data. Yeah. And in fact, all the values are the same.
Yes,
apart
ma'am.
From just the test statistic. And, well, I'm sorry. I don't know why this is happening. This has to be something.
SPSS version may be different and simulation may be different.
Maybe because of the new version and the old version of SPSS.
And level of simulation may be different.
I agree with that, the version of SPSS, but again, I think the calculation of the test statistic is the same. So it
Madam,
should
the
not
differ. Important.
It's the same.
The calculation is same, despite using the different
exactly.
The result will be same. The data are
exactly.
same.
Exactly. It should not differ. Because the formula that they are using is the same for all the time. It's been the same. They cannot change the formula, right? They can change the significance value, but not the formula. The
okay, let us explore the reasons later on. We have 2 days.
Yes, I'll definitely look into it. I'll get it checked with some of my students that if it is happening with them too. But there should be some kind of explanation, I think. Anyways, so I'll share my screen again. Okay, so this was the normality test. Now we'll go back to our testing of hypothesis. So, So one more thing, let's go with the graph part also. We can test the normality of a distribution. We can check the normality of a distribution sample values by the method of graphs also. Okay, so in your title bar, what we have is we have different tabs. Okay, go for graphs, then go for chart builder. Right, I'm resetting it. So in chart builder, we in the left box of the variables, we have all three variables that we have, right? And in the lower left bottom, we have the box showing that what graph you want to choose. So testing the normality is simple. You just have to choose your variable. You don't have to go
now,
for any.
Would you show this step again? Would you show this step again?
Yes, definitely. So the path is go into graphs, okay? Select chart builder, and there's your tab. Okay, graphs and chart builder, that's all. So in the left bottom, you can see that it is showing you the different kind of graphs that the SPSS is providing. Whether it's bar or line or area, pie, scatter, histogram, box plot. Okay, so for checking the normality of a data, we usually use two kind of graphs. One is histogram and box plot. There is PP plot and QQ plot also, but we don't have to go that far because it's not necessary. So the simplest method will be choosing histogram, and we are choosing the simple histogram here. Okay, so here is your histogram. So iske hame zarurat nahi, just go and drag your anxiety level on the x-axis. Okay, so you chose it and then you click okay. You don't have to go for any other options, you just have to click okay. So where is my graph? See, the value that it was showing, it was 0.678, right? And the data was normal. The value 0.678 is significantly higher from 0.05, right? So it is, the data has to be normal. Now, if you see the graph, you can see that the anxiety level, it is going like this, right? So though the values are little bit up and down,
ma'am,
in the middle, yeah,
can you repeat once again this step,
the path? Okay, no problem. Go at the title bar, then go at the graphs. Okay, and in graphs go for chart builder. Okay, so you don't have to opt for, you can write down the paths, you know, if you want to remember it for later purpose. So go for chart builder, click on chart builder, and what you do is, I'll reset it again. So in the left top box you can see your variables, okay, and in the left bottom you have the options to choose the graphs. So for checking the normality of the distribution, we can either go for histogram or box plot. So in histogram, we are going to select the simplest of the histogram just to see the frequency distribution. I understand the frequency distribution like this, okay? So whether the data should go in the normal distribution kind of form or not. So double click on that, right? इसको क्रॉस करिए, डबल क्लिक किया आपने, यू हैवंट सेलेक्टेड एनी वेरिएबल राइट नाउ, दैट्स व्हाई इट्स शोइंग सिंपल दिस. व्हाट यू विल डू इज यू ड्रैग द एंजाइटी वन एंजाइटी वेरिएबल एंड ड्रॉप इट इनटू द एक्स एक्सिस. गेटिंग इट, ड्रॉप इट लाइक दिस. सो इट इज शोइंग यू द सिंपल हिस्टोग्राम ऑफ द फ्रीक्वेंसी डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन ऑफ your variable anxiety, that's all. So you click on okay and there is your graph. Everyone has got it, right?
Ma'am, when I'm clicking the graph and chart builder,
yeah,
an option is showing before you use this dialogue, measurement level should be set properly for each variable in your chart. Okay, they are not. Then what should I do?
You can just simply press OK. Yeah.
OK. Yeah. OK.
OK.
Wo apni side se, it's just giving you a warning that it should be like that. Otherwise, your chart will not be perfect, I think.
OK. OK. Thank you, ma'am.
So you have clicked on okay, you are following the procedure, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so you can see the graph here and you can see that the end values like below 30 and above 60, it's following a pattern, and on the top you can see that it is not like a very aberrated manner, it's simply going like this. Okay, so in broader perspective, the graph is approximating to a bell shaped form. So from the graph we can see that it is not perfectly normal, but it is normal, right? And but the test confirms that your distribution is normal. So that's one good thing of statistical tests, that you can actually mathematically prove whether your distribution is normal or not. So you can go simply go for histograms. Another thing that you can go for is box plot. So in box plot, you'll choose box plot here. You have to choose simple box plot, right? So simple box plot aapne choose kiya. You have to put anxiety. We have already put anxiety, right? We don't need that. Okay, and then click on OK, and it will show you the box plot. So see, the box plot is showing that the middle line is in the middle of the box. That is okay. Okay. But you have to also check the tails of the, that you call whiskers. These are called whiskers. So the whiskers of the box plot, this and this. It is showing you the data, how the data is varying in the scale of your distribution. So just try to invert this graph clockwise. So just flip your PC or something in clockwise a little, just once. And you can see that this bar is lying exactly in the middle of the box. And you can see that this tail is shorter than this tail. Okay. So the data, the concentration of the data is more on the right whisker or the upper whisker of the box plot. Okay, so it is simply confirming what you made in histogram. Okay, it's the same. And the line that is in the middle is showing that the distribution is normal. If this line would have been tilted in the lower portion of the box, or the upper portion of the box, then your data would have been non-normal. Okay?
Ma'am, box plot ka ye path, can you show once more? Ek bar
phir yeah, se. Sure.
Ma'am, histogram ka bhi show kar dijiye ek bar.
Sure. Main kaam karti hu, I would speak the path and you can write down the path and then you can run it again and again. That would be better. Okay? So go to graphs, write down graphs, go to graphs, then go to chart builder. Then I'll reset it. So for histogram, select histogram from the lower box. This window would have opened already. Select histogram, select the simple histogram. Then you have to select the variable. So you drag and drop in the x-axis, anxiety. Okay? And then just click OK. So there's your histogram. That was the path for histogram. And for the graphs, chart builder, for box plot, the same path is there. You just have to change the graph or the diagram. And go for simple box plot. The other two are clustered and they show the outliers and all, but we don't have to get into that. We just have to choose the simple box plot. And we have already chosen the variable. Or otherwise, you can just drag and drop it back. See, drag and drop. It's very easy. Drag and drop. Drag and drop. Okay, so you dragged and dropped it, and then you again click OK, and here's your box plot. Clear? So if you have multiple variables, you can simply go for that. So you can run it on your another variable. So we had the spider picture, that is nominal data, right? So you can just go for spider picture. This is not taking. Can anyone tell me why it is not taking the values? Mm-hmm. is you can go for try and error method and you can try for this. So everyone has noted the path for this, right? And everyone got the concept of checking normality using the plots, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, great. So there's no doubt for that. So we can go back to our theory again. Okay. So in this lecture, we just had to check the normality test for the distributions, right? Now there are two kind of testing of hypothesis. One is parametric testing of hypothesis, and another one is non-parametric testing of hypothesis. As I was saying earlier, that there are a lot of cases when we cannot simply assume that the parent population is normal, or we cannot simply say that we know a lot about the parameters of the parent population, right? So when we have the proper information or all the information about the parameters of the parent population from where our sample is being drawn, then you can go for parametric testing of hypothesis. Parameters, everyone understand parameters, right? Parameters are the are those particular constants of your study on the basis of which you judge your sample and your population, right? And these parameters are usually taken as mean, variance, median, mode, like that. Okay, it's usually that, standard deviation. So these are the population parameters. So if you have any information about the parameters of the parent population, then you can use the parametric testing of hypothesis. And any information that will be the distribution of the parent population, or the values of the mean or variance of the parent population. Okay. Parametric tests are basically applied on interval or ratio scale. Aap wahi apply kar sakte hain. If your variables are nominal or ordinal in nature, then you cannot apply parametric testing. Right? So then you have to go for non-parametric testing. Distribution of the parent population from which the sample is drawn should be known. Usually it is normal, but it can differ as per your study. The sample should be drawn randomly from the population, of course, because if the sample is drawn randomly, then we can say that our error is also distributed randomly, right? So there are no kind of, there is no bias in your study or in drawing your sample. This is very simple and easy to remember and understand where you have to apply for parametric and non-parametric. So non-parametric tests are considered to be easy because if you have no information about the parent population, then you can simply go for non-parametric testing of hypothesis. But then why prefer parametric hypothesis over non-parametric? Usually, parametric testing of hypothesis is considered to be more apt or appropriate. Why it should be like that? Any inputs? See, when you know about your parent population, the parameters of your population, the results that will come out will be more precise. So the parametric testing of hypothesis gives you accurate results. The accuracy in the testing of hypothesis under parametric testing gives you accurate results. So if you have, if you can apply the parametric testing, or if you have the information about the parent population, then you can conclude better results about your sample distribution, and you can compare easily whether it is one sample or two sample or multiple samples. Okay. So the parametric testing can be used on ordinal or nominal data, or as well as the ratio and interval scale data. It can be applied on both. So when we were talking about one sample KS test, is actually a non-parametric test, but it is applied to check the normality of any kind of data. Okay. So it can be applied if the parent population is not known, and whether the samples are biased or unbiased or taken randomly, it doesn't matter. But the accuracy confines to the small sized samples only. We cannot conclude the results when the samples are large. So sometimes it happens to us when some research researchers, they come to us and they say that this is our data and the data is of for the size of 100. And they say, okay, ma'am, please apply a t-test on it and give us the results. The situation then arises is that a t-test is a small sample test. Okay. And if you go for non-parametric test, all the tests are for small samples. So if you go for small sample test and the sample is actually very large, the results that you will get will not be as accurate as in small samples. Okay, the validity of those particular tests will only be restricted to small samples, not large samples. Okay, so there are different tests. T-test is there, which is for small sample. The Z-test is there, which is for large samples. Okay, so the T-test, if applied to large sample, it will give you the result. If you apply T-test in SPSS on any large sample, it will definitely give you some output, but that output will be not as reliable as if we use the Z test instead of T test. So there are some small sample tests and there are large sample tests, TEF, we have F test and Z test that are large sample tests that we can use for the samples which are very large. So it is not suggested that we apply a small sample test and all that in larger samples, because the accuracy is actually compromised and then there is no relevance of your study whether you are doing it anyways. So what parametric tests to apply? Well, the detail of these parametric tests, I believe it will be discussed to you in the later lectures on other days. But in short, there is this summary that in case if we have a parametric testing of hypothesis, so for parametric testing of hypothesis, what you do is you first check the normality of your data. So if you have a scale variable, ratio variable hona chahiye. So whether it is ratio or interval. So what you do is you check the normality of your data first. And if it is normal, then you can just close your eyes and you can go for a parametric test. Okay, it's as simple as that. But if it is not normal, then the problem persists that if it is not normal, then what distribution is it? And if you don't know the distribution of the parametric of the parent population, then you have nothing, right? Then you go for non-parametric test. So there are these are the tests which you can apply for parametric testing of hypothesis. So when you have one sample, single sample, and you want to check whether the average value is equal to some standard value or not, then you can use the single sample t-test. So if we have time, I think I can explain one or two tests. So there is single sample t-test. It is applied for testing a value if it is equals to some standard value or not. Okay, so basically assumption is simple. Assumption of t-test is very simple. The parameter, the parent population should be normal and sample observation should be independent. So what we did was in single sample test, the mean will be, the null hypothesis will be the sample mean is equals to mean stated in null hypothesis. That you have to remember, that your null hypothesis is that, because on the basis of that, you're going to take the decision, right? So I'm going to my sample data and you have the level of anxiety and the groups, right? So if you want to check that, for example, in anxiety one, whether the value, the average anxiety is equals to some kind of numerical value or not, it's very simple. Okay. So we made the assumptions like this, that the sample mean anxiety is equals to mean that is stated in null hypothesis. So let us make a null hypothesis that the average anxiety level in anxiety one group is, say, suppose 40. Okay, so we have to check for 40, right? So what you'll do is you go to analyze, then you go to compare means, इसका पाथ लिख लीजिए प्लीज. यू गो टू एनालाइज, देन गो टू कंपेयर मीन्स, एंड देन यू ऑप्ट फॉर वन सैंपल टू बी टेस्ट. ओके. Is everyone clear with the path?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So you choose one sample t-test, right? So it's a very small, very sweet, small dialog box. It's very easy, right? So you choose anxiety one. Why am I choosing anxiety one? Because I know that it is already normal, so I can go for it, right? So again, in the option, it will ask you, see, now this is giving you the confidence interval percentage. Yeah, you can change whether it should be 99% or 95% or 90%. Let's go with the default case, 95%, let it be. The test value. The test value is the value that we state in null hypothesis. So we were saying that we want to check whether the average anxiety is equal to 40 or not. So you go for 40. Right, and then we click OK. Right, so here it is. Pehla uska unka syntax hai that they run. Then the simple statistics that they give, descriptives basically. Total number of observations, mean, standard deviation, and standard error in mean, sigma by root n, jisko aap kehte hain. The next is the table where they have applied one sample test. Okay. So the first value is the value of t statistic, 1.618. The second is degrees of freedom. So we are testing for mean, so it honest automatically comes out to be n minus 1. So it is 23. The significance value that they are giving is two-tailed significance values. And the mean difference and the confidence interval of the difference. So the mean difference is basically based on the formulation of the t statistic. It calculates the difference of every value from the mean that you have stated, mu naught. So it will calculate the average value from the difference, right? So if we have this much of sample values and we have test value like this one, so it will compare each and every observation and check the difference from the stated observation, the in null hypothesis. So it was like first, let's assume that first one is 35 and we stated the null hypothesis to be 40. So 35 minus 40, 35. Okay, so it will take the average difference. So it will take the average difference, right? Then next and next and next and next. So mean difference is the average difference. So average difference is showing as 3.5. Confidence interval difference, it is showing as 0.9.7, 7.97. It is simply the 95% confidence limits. Okay. So what we have to judge upon is the significance values of two-tailed significance values of the statistic. And it is coming out to be 0.119. What does it say? Our H naught was mu is equals to 40, right? And the value is greater than 0.05, right? So what you will do? Your p-value, the significance value, is greater than 0.05. What you do in this case?
We will accept.
We accept the null hypothesis. So null hypothesis is accepted. That means that the average level of anxiety is equals to 40. Okay? It is the statistically significant result. Okay. So it's quite higher than 0.05. So we can say that it is largely significant. Right. So that's how you apply a t-test. So in the slides, I have shown what kind of decision that how much significance is there. So when the p value is small, obviously, then we obviously say that we don't have enough evidence. we have a strong evidence that our null hypothesis is invalid, and so we reject the null hypothesis. When the p-value on the contradictory part is greater than 0.05, that means you don't have enough evidence to reject the null hypothesis. Okay, so you go for accepting the null hypothesis, right? So if the value p-value is greater than, so this is important because we usually write down that how much it is, if it is highly significant or marginally significant. Okay, so if the p-value comes out to be greater than 0.10, then the result it's not significant, right? If it is less than equals to 0.10, then marginally significant. If it is less than equals to 0.05, then it is significant. And if it is less than 0.01, then it is highly significant. So here our value is coming out to be 0.119. What does it mean? It means that the difference is not significant. The difference that we are checking is not significant. That means our mu is equals to 40. It was checking the average difference, no, so it was not significant. So we are accepting the null hypothesis. Similarly, in the next case, in the non-parametric case, I have stated here what if the p-values are greater or less than. So it's almost the same between the both. So in this case, the parametric testing of hypothesis, the t-test has this good applicability over different samples. So it can be applied for single sample. It can be applied for testing the mean difference between two samples which are independent, and we can check the mean difference between two samples which are paired. So independent samples are mutually exclusive samples where the values in one is not affecting the observations in the second sample. Okay, so in our sample data, the practice data set, we considered a group of people who were shown actual spider and who were shown the picture of a spider, right? So the groups were mutually exclusive. They didn't relate to each other in any way. They were not associated. So they were independent samples. There you can test the independent sample t-test. Now the paired sample t-test will be for an example, for paired samples. For example, we took a test of 10 students and we got their marks, right? And we have those results. What we do is then we provide them counseling, okay? And we take the test of those particular 10 students again, and we take out the scores. And then we compare that this counseling has been has been significant to the scores of the students or not. So here the samples become paired because the objects on which the observations were taken are the same. One is pre-experiment and another is post-experiment. Or otherwise you can divide it and you can make it independent samples. Okay, when you have more than two samples, then you apply ANOVA test. Okay, it's ANOVA is basically the analysis of variance in which you compare several means. If you have one mean, then you can compare more than two means. Okay, so these are the parametric testing of hypothesis, and these are the null hypothesis in different kind of tests. So if we have independent sample t-test, that means our null hypothesis will be mean of sample 1 is equals to mean of sample 2. If we have paired sample t-test, then mean of sample 1 minus mean of sample 2 should be equals to 0. Okay? That will be your null hypothesis. That means the difference is not significant. And for ANOVA, it will be mean of sample 1 equals to mean of sample 2 and then mean of sample 3 and so on and so forth.
Madam, is it going to be different for ANOVA, multiple variance?
So multiple analysis of variance is different when we have multivariate distribution. Okay. It is not multivariate. It is simple distribution where variables are too many. But multivariate has like two-dimensional metrics we have. So it becomes a little complicated. But we have multiple observations on single variable. It becomes multivariable. Right? So that becomes a complicated matrix. So in that case, we apply MANOVA, multivariate analysis of variance. Then we have decision rule for this, and then we have parametric, non-parametric tests that also will be discussed with you in the later lectures, right? So in case of one sample, you can apply one sample KS test. So one sample KS test, we were checking the normality. We can also check the other part, that was binomial distribution and Poisson distribution and exponential distribution, right? Then we have chi-square test and binomial test. That is also for a single sample. When we have two independent samples, then we have Mann-Whitney-U test. And if we have two paired samples, then we have Wilcoxon test, McNamara test. Okay, and the situation, there's a condition for McNamara test. When the variables are dichotomous in nature, or you can say binary in nature, when it has only two outcomes, right? Then only you can apply McNamara test, otherwise you cannot. So we have these two tests for that. Then we have K samples. If we have K independent samples, then you can apply Kruskal-Wallis. And we have, if we have K related samples, like paired, right? So if we have K related samples, then we have different tests again. In those, we have Friedman test, Cochran Q test. And again, Cochran has the condition where if the variable is dichotomous in nature, then only you can apply it, otherwise not. So these are the non-parametric tests that you can apply, and this is the null hypothesis. I believe this will all be discussed with you and with hands-on practice in the next session. Okay, and there you have Friedman test and the null hypothesis for that. Decision rules are the same for parametric and non-parametric testing. And this will conclude my lecture on testing of hypothesis. Before ending it, I just want to say that testing of hypothesis is a little detailed process, right? So you have to understand from the very beginning of your research, you have to understand the nature of your data. First of all, you have to go into the depth of your data, whether it is a primary data or a secondary data, and the initial stage is very much important, where you make the hypothesis and where you judge what kind of testing you want to apply. So it is very much important that you are applying the right kind of test and in your study so that the results are good. And the more you dig into the data, the better results you will get. That is very true, and everyone knows that. And with that, I'll conclude my lecture. I wish I had more. I think I could have done more with the time. Over to you, sir.